Our Bible lesson for this evening is in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 1 through 18. John 1, 1 through 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that through him all men might believe. Him himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet, to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known." This is the word of the Lord. As I would sing here during this Christmas season, every Sunday, and today we're going to have a testimony. So we have the Gospels, the authors of the Gospels giving their testimony here to our church. So today is the last day of this series, and we're going to have the Apostle John here with us. So John will be here with us shortly. You all know that I'm John, right? I'm old. Yeah. I'm the last one. I'm the last apostle. You're not here anymore. Good group. Yeah. And I was not a disciple of Jesus at the beginning. I was a disciple of John the Baptist, who heard about him. A prophet, a powerful prophet, that came preaching and preparing the way for the Messiah. And we believed that the Messiah was about to come, and we started following John the Baptist. And he was baptized, and he was prophesied. He was a tremendous ministry in Judea, Galilee, and all that area. But John said to us something. He said, "Look, I am not the light. I am not him. I'm just preparing the way for him." And we didn't understand well, but one day we saw Jesus passing, and we were with John, and John stopped. And he pointed to Jesus and said, just see, that is the Lamb of God that take away the sin of the world. It's Him. It's Him. I'm not worth, not even to tie His sandals. It's Him. I came to prepare the way for Him. So that is stuck in our minds and hearts, and we try to understand what He was saying. And one day we were fishing. My family and Peter and his family, we had a business together. And we fishing. And one day we were just kind of finished fishing, we're cleaning the nets and the boat and everything, and then we saw Jesus coming. And you could feel that there's something of Him. And He stopped by, I saw He stopping on Peter with his brother, and then after that they came together. And then Jesus stopped where James and I were, and He said, I want you to follow me. Come with me. It was exciting. So we packed everything and left the next day on the boat, and we started walking with Him, and we walked with Him. I'm walking with Him my whole life. Was the most special experience that someone can have in this earth. Walk with Jesus. And Jesus had 12 guys. Well, He had more people. They had 72, and then He had the 12 guys. And on out of the 12, He had a small group. It was Peter, James, and I. We are called the special one, because every time that Jesus had something special going on, He would invite us to go. So we went there to watch Him to give life back to a little girl, and then we went there to see the transfiguration. It was just the three of us. But I had the privilege to be the closer one with Him. I was the closer with Him. We walked together, we talked, we sit. Every time that we sit together, I was there close to Him, sitting, eating, talking, listening, learning, watching, everything. You cannot imagine. And today we're celebrating His birth, and it's special, and you need to understand how special it is. I wrote my gospel. My gospel was the last one. The last one. All the apostles died. We didn't have all the apostles anymore. And at the time when I wrote, the church was growing and it's spreading all over the world. The mission work of the church was spreading all over the place. And then the people from outside the church was coming inside the church, and they were bringing their religion, they were bringing their philosophy, they were bringing their teaching, they were bringing their everything that they think about religion, they are trying to adapt to Christianity. So we got some Greeks that were bringing something about, yes, Jesus was a good man, a good philosopher, teacher, but this is it. And then we have the Jewish people coming in and saying, no, you have to follow Moses before you follow Jesus. And all those kind of things. When they are changing things about Jesus, they didn't believe that Jesus was the Son of God. They didn't believe that. They didn't believe a lot of things. So I decided to write my book, the Holy Spirit pressed my heart to write a book to the Gentiles, the whole world, the church spread all over the world, and tell them about Jesus, the real Jesus, the Jesus that I walked with, the Jesus that I knew, the Jesus that I heard, that I touched, the Jesus that I saw healing people and doing miracles. I started groaning, but I have one thing in mind, totally different from the other three Gospels that you read. Matthew wrote to the Jewish people, and he did a great job, you know. You see all the prophecies that he cited, he's good. Matthew, I remember watching him sitting there, writing everything that Jesus was saying. It was amazing. And then you have Mark with Peter writing for the Romans, and then you have Luke writing for the Greek. But now, at the end of the first century, in your calendar, the church needed to see Jesus, the real Jesus, who that Jesus was. Because they were changing Jesus into something else. So what I put in my gospel is simple. But when you read the gospel, you're going to see how simple it is. I was specific in the teaching, specific in the encounters, specific in everything that I picked to narrate there, has few objectives. Let me share with you what they are. The first one is to show Jesus that Jesus is God. Simple like that. Jesus is not a good man only. Jesus is not a good teacher. Jesus is not a philosopher. He is God Himself. God Himself. Powerful God. This is why I wrote the beginning of my gospel. The beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He's not another teacher, another prophet, another pastor, shepherd, no, another philosopher, no, he's God. The other thing that you're going to find in my gospel is that Jesus is the Son of God incarnated. And that is the biggest challenge for the Gentile people, for the Greeks is the biggest challenge. They believe that Jesus was a special man, that God gave him gifts, so he was above the average. He also was above everybody else, but this was it. That was it. And it was not. Jesus is God. He came in flesh. And this is why I wrote in my gospel that God made a tabernacle and walk among us. Yes, God Himself with flesh. Some people believe at that time when I wrote the gospel, some people believe that Jesus was not a man, He was a God. And you could see some humanity on Him, but He was not a man. He didn't have flesh. And you know what? This is why I decided to write that gospel. Because I walked with Him, I saw Him drinking, I saw Him suffering, I saw Him upset with the sun and the heat of the desert. I saw Him getting tired. He was a man. But God at the same time. So when you read my gospel, you will understand that Jesus is God, and Jesus is God incarnated. He took flesh. And this is important because there is no salvation without that. A good man cannot save you. I, John, cannot save you. He has to be God Himself. A perfect person to be sacrificed, to be the lamb take away the sins of the world. And Jesus was and is that. But there is one more thing that, one more reason why I wrote that gospel. Not only to share that Jesus is God, and that was very important for the people, for the church, for the people that are coming to the church, they had all those ideas. Not only that, the idea was, He's not only God, He's God incarnated, He's God that walked with us, was born in this world. There's one more thing. I need to make Jesus, that God, my personal God. I need to make a decision to surrender my life. If Jesus is God, if Jesus is God incarnate, whatever He did, whatever He said, is from God Himself. If that is true, you have just two options. Follow Him, or you turn your back to Him. Only two options. You follow Him, you surrender to Him, you accept Him, or not. Jesus Christ said there when they said that those who believe, those who accept, God gave them power to become or to be called children of God. Yeah. Those who surrender, those who believe, those who accept, God empowered them to be their children, their children, His children. They are His children. And today we're celebrating His birth. And there is no other time better than this for you to be face to face with Christ. Face to face with Christ. Recognize and believe that He's God and He's God incarnated, and give your life to Him. And surrender your life to Him. And accept Him and believe Him. Not that He's a good teacher, not that He's a philosopher, not that He's a good man. No, not like that. He is God, God incarnated, and He is the Savior. You need to believe. And my prayer for you is that if you never thought about that, that the Spirit of God will touch your heart and move your heart toward Jesus. I cannot do that, you cannot do that, your church cannot do that, your wife, your husband, your parents cannot do that. Only the Spirit of God and its Word can do that. To move your heart, to open your heart to Him and receive Him in your life. Let us bow our heads, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that Your Spirit will touch everyone here in this sanctuary. Those who are already following Jesus, we pray that they will renew their commitment. Those who never did, pray that Spirit who opened their hearts and helped them to surrender